Father, we bless your name. We give you the praise. We worship your holy name. We thank you for being a good God, a wonderful God. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for this day. This is the day that you have made for us to rejoice. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father. We bless your name. We just want to thank you for the appointment that we have with you. This morning, we thank you that you're giving us this day our daily bread. Thank you and we bless you. We give it glory. As we get into your word, we pray for transition. We pray for transformation. We pray for your anointing to destroy the yoke upon our lives in the name of Jesus. We thank you and we bless you. And I cover your children wherever they are with the blood of the Lamb, and I speak victory right now in Jesus' name. In whatever situation they are in, I declare victory in the blood of Jesus. Father, we thank you. Father, we bless your name. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. Let me take this opportunity to greet all of you, ladies and gentlemen, our brothers and sisters in the Lord, in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. God is good. The Lord is good. Amen. Hallelujah. Before I get into the word of the Lord, I just want to remind you of our prayer and fasting starting from tomorrow, amen, Monday until Friday, amen. So we're going to be busy with prayer and fasting, and we're requesting Bazalwana, if you feel a bit hungry or thirsty, just make sure that you drink water or juice. Amen. We are going to break in the evening, all of us. Amen. After 8. Remember, we have a Zoom prayer from 7 to 8. So after 8, then we will break. Amen. For those who don't have airtime, we will be sending you prayer items on the WhatsApps. Amen. So you can be able to pray. Amen. God bless you. I want us to get into the word of the Lord. And the past 2-3 weeks, I was busy with the mind and the power of the mind. Last week, we talked about mental renovation. And I believe that even today, we still on the mind. Amen. And I want us to look at something very interesting in 1 Kings chapter 19. From verse 1 to 9, and then we'll also read 15, 16, and 17. Amen. 1 Kings chapter 19, I read. Now Ahab told Jezebel everything Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah to say, "May the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I don't make your life like that of one of them." Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servants there while he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. He came to a broom bush, sat down under it and prayed that he might die. "I've had enough, Lord," he said. "Take my life. I'm no better than my ancestors." Then he lay down under the bush and fell asleep. All at once, an angel touched him and said, "Get up and eat." He looked around, thereby his head was some bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water. He ate and drank and then lay down again. The angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and said, "Get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you." So he got up and ate and drank. Strengthened by that food, he traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. Then he went into a cave and spent the night, and the word of the Lord came to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Remember, he is now in the cave in Mount Horeb, and he hears the presence of God and stands at the entrance of the cave. I just want to skip other verses. And then I'm in verse 15 now. The Lord said to him, "Go back the way you came and go to the desert of Damascus. When you get there, anoint Hazael, king of Syria, and also anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, king over Israel, and anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, from Abel Meholah to succeed you as a prophet." May the Lord bless the reading of his word. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm looking at chapter 19, and I'm asking myself, what happened to this mighty man of God, Elijah, the man who calls fire from heaven and it comes down? And in chapter 19, Elijah wants to die. He is asking God to kill him. And now I'm asking myself, how can Elijah want to die? How can Elijah have depression? I'm asking myself, where is the Elijah of chapter 17? The Elijah of chapter 18? What happened to Elijah, brethren? Make me realize that no one is immune to mental sickness. No one is immune to mental depression. In chapter 17, let's look at the power and might of Elijah. In chapter 17, he is a man walking in authority. He goes to the king Ahab and he says to him, "There shall not be rain nor dew except at my word." That is a man of authority. Hallelujah. We see in the same chapter a man walking in divine provision. God takes him to the brook called Cherith, and he provides him there, and he commands the ravens to feed him. Hallelujah. If you haven't seen God as Elijah, I mean, if ravens can feed you, then you must understand you are walking in the presence of God. And now we see a man also walking in divine overflow. He is with the widow of Zarephath, and there is a miracle of multiplication. The Bible says the oil and the flour did not get finished. Hallelujah. That is walking in divine overflow. That is Elijah the Tishbite for you. In chapter 18, we see a man walking under the anointing. Hallelujah. Elijah challenges the prophets of Baal. One man against 500 prophets. A man of courage, a man full of the anointing, a man full of fire, a man of faith. He calls fire from heaven, and fire falls down at Mount Carmel, and it swallows everything on the altar, including the altar itself and the stones on the altar. And when chapter 18 closes, it closes powerfully so. It closes with Elijah praying for the rain. Remember, there was famine for 3.5 years.
And now he is praying. He is on his knees. He is praying for the rain. And he doesn't stand up until rain comes down. And now a servant says, I see the cloud the size of a man's fist. And he says, go and tell King Ahab that he must prepare because there is abundance of rain coming. That is a man full of power. That is a man full of anointing. And now the Bible says when it closes with divine overtaking anointing. My God. Hallelujah. Ahab is on a chariot. He's inside a car. He is running. Hallelujah. As commanded by the prophet Elijah. And now Elijah is on his feet. The Bible says he started walking, running, and under the anointing, he overtook King Ahab, who was on a chariot. That is the man I'm talking about, Elijah himself. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. In chapter 19, he is another different Elijah. He is another different Elijah. He is isolated. He cuts off himself from people. He even chases the servant who was serving him. He says, you stay here. He goes alone. Those are signs of depression. He is paranoid. He feels he's the only one serving God. He feels he's the only one being abused. He feels he is the only one. He imagines everyone wants to kill him. It's not Jezebel, it's Ahab. Everyone is just after him. Paranoia. He is exhausted. He is lying down because he is tired, not because of the journey. He is tired because of what he is going through. And now he is in hiding. He is lying down in the cave, hallelujah, under the tree. Glory to Jesus. Because depression will make you to lock yourself inside. Depression will make you to hide yourself and not want to see people, even those who are ready to help you. Hallelujah. And now we see a classical presentation of depression. He prays that he might die. He now has suicidal ideations. He is in a depressive mode. He is in depression. And Barcelona, I want us today to look at this, and we are going to destroy the spirit of heaviness this morning. We are going to destroy the spirit of depression. Hallelujah. In our families, in our church. Hallelujah. Glory to the Lord. Amen. Because Elijah was a man walking with God. And this shows that depression can affect anyone. It can affect the rich. It can affect the poor. It can affect the young. It can affect the old. It can affect every race. Amen. It does not choose. Amen. Because money cannot buy you peace or sleep. Achievement, fame, and success doesn't overcome depression. Anyone, including Christians and anointed men and women of God, can get into depression. No one is immune from depression. As a church, we need to address it and overcome it, because you cannot overcome something you do not confront. You need to confront it so that you can overcome it. Hallelujah. You can have the best things in life. You can be powerful on the pulpit. You can be powerful in the office, wherever you are working in your business. But you find yourself like where Elijah was. Hallelujah. Let me tell you something. It doesn't matter what is happening. Material things will not help you. Hallelujah. Having a king-size bed or in an air-conditioned bedroom can't give you sleep. Only the presence of God will. Only the Spirit of God will. That's why we need to seek after the kingdom of God. That's why we need to seek after God before these other things, because it is Him who will give us the power and the peace of God to overcome. Hallelujah. He says, I will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is on me. Glory to the Lord. And now Jezebel threatens Elijah, hallelujah. And he says, by tomorrow, this time, I will have done the same thing you did to the prophets of Baal. And now Elijah is fearful, and now he is threatened by Jezebel, the woman. Hallelujah. Remember, the woman never came to him and showed him a gun, never came to him and with soldiers or whatever. She just said a word. She just said a word and threatens. Hallelujah. And threats, I beg your pardon. She just threatened Elijah. And now Elijah is fearful because he heard that someone wants to kill him. Hallelujah. Let me talk about the fear for a while before I get into my message. Hallelujah. You see, fear is very dangerous, amen, in life, because the devil operates through fear. The devil wants you to get you and I so timid and fearful that we can't do anything for ourselves and also for God. Fear paralyzes us from doing what God has called us to do. Let me tell you, Rodard Kipling says, of all the lies in the world you have been told, the worst are your own fears. It is your own fear that is actually lying to you more than people lying to you. And this fear, it is now lying to Elijah that Jezebel is more powerful than you. It is now lying to Elijah that Jezebel is more powerful. She is actually going to destroy you. She is actually going to, it's all over, Elijah. It's all over. Fear tells him that she's gonna get you. Hallelujah. But I want to speak to someone this morning that the Lord is wonderful, the Lord is good, because fear is the opposite of faith, and faith is the opposite of faith. Someone said that fear is false evidence appearing real. My God, I'm helping someone write about that. Hallelujah. Let me tell you, there's nothing real about it. There's nothing real about Jezebel. She will not do anything to Elijah. Hallelujah. But just because of a threat, Elijah is fearful. There's nothing real about it. It's just false evidence appearing real. What you are going through right now, that situation, is just false evidence appearing real. My God, whatever is making you fearful, you must just understand it is just false evidence appearing real. Hallelujah. There is no need to fear. Former President Nelson Mandela, he quoted a very powerful quote. I quote, he says, I learned that courage was not the absence of fear, but the triumph over it. Courage is not the absence of fear, amen, but the courage to triumph over it, which means Nelson Mandela is saying to you, whatever you are fearful of, you have to have the courage to triumph over whatever you are fearful of, which means you must go confront what you fear. My God, confront your fears. Hallelujah. And he says, the brave man is not he who does not feel afraid, but he who conquers that fear. Listen to what Zig Ziglar says. He says, fear has two meanings. F-E-A-R. Has two meanings. Number one, forget everything and run. But the second meaning means face everything and rise. Oh my God. Hallelujah. Forget, that's F, everything, E, and run, A-R. Hallelujah. And number two, the opposite. He says, face everything and then rise. My God. Which one are you going for? When you are in fear, when you are afraid, when you are uncertain about the future, what are you going for? Hallelujah. Are you going to forget everything and run like Elijah? The devil is a liar. Hallelujah. I'm going to face everything and rise, because when I face it, I sure will conquer it and rise up, because God is on my side. There's something that I know as a child of God, that I am not alone. I am not alone. He said, do not fear, in Isaiah 43 verse 1. I am with you. I have summoned you by name. I know you by name. I am with you. Let me ask you a challenge. Why are you so nervous? Why are you so nervous? Why are you so anxious, Elijah? Hallelujah. Let me tell you. God says, fear not. And the phrase fear not appears almost 80 times in the Bible. Fear not, fear not, fear not, times 80. God is saying to you 80 times. He is saying to you, fear not. When you go through whatever, fear not. When you go through the valley, fear not. When you go through and climb the mountain, fear not. When you go through the winter season, fear not. When you go through a financial challenge, fear not. When you go through a marital challenge, fear not. When your children are misbehaving, fear not. He's gonna be all right. He did not bring you this far to leave you. God is a wonderful God. I want to speak to an Elijah this morning. I want to tell you, do not fear Jezebel. I know he is powerful, but there is more powerful that you are with. Hallelujah. She is strong, but you are walking with the strongest. I know she is big in Samaria, in Syria, but you are now walking with a God who is bigger than Jezebel. You are bigger. You are the problem with you, Elijah. This time you have magnified Jezebel and you forgot to magnify the Lord. That's why David says, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together, because he understands that when you magnify God, you magnify him. And when you magnify and you make him big, remember, he is already big. You are just making him big in your situation. He is already big. You are just making him big in your fire. God is already big. You are making him big wherever you are. When you magnify him and you say you are great, your mountain becomes smaller. When you magnify him and you say, be exalted, my God, your mountain gets flattened. Magnify the Lord. The problem with us, we magnify a Jezebel in our lives. We magnify a Goliath in our lives, and we forget that God has never lost a battle. Even Goliath today, I want to tell him this morning that you are defeated. You are defeated. You are under my feet, because I'm not coming in my own name. I am coming in the name of the Lord. Magnify the Lord with me. Hallelujah. That is the problem. That's why we are fearful. The reason we are fearful, we forget, hallelujah, that God is greater. There is none besides him. We forget that he is a wonderful God. We forget he is Jehovah Nissi. We forget he is Jehovah Shammah. We forget he is mighty warrior. We forget he is Jehovah Sabaoth. We forget he is mighty in Bethel. We forget that, oh my God, we forget that when he takes you out, he takes you out and sustains you. We forget that he is with you. We forget that he will keep you. We forget all that, my God. That's why David says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Hallelujah. Why are you nervous? Why are you nervous? Why are you nervous? Fear not. Philippians says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, present your request to the Lord. Hallelujah. which means offload whatever you're going through to the Lord. That Jezebel, just offload it to the Lord. Hallelujah. Why are you so anxious? Why are you so anxious? Let me tell you, if you cannot handle it, you have a God that can. If you cannot do it, you have a God that can. There is no circumstance that he cannot handle. There is no problem too big that he cannot solve. There is no mountain too tall that God cannot move it. There is no storm too dark that God cannot calm it. There is no sorrow too deep that the Lord cannot soothe it. Am I speaking to someone this morning? He prays for God to kill him. Can you imagine? What a powerful man of God. Hallelujah. He just called fire from heaven. Hallelujah. And fire came upon Mount Carmel, upon the altar. And now in chapter 19, he is saying, he is praying, Lord, just kill me. Instead of Jezebel killing me, you rather just kill me. He now wants to die. And I want to thank the Lord that God does not answer his prayer. I want to thank God, my God. This man understands prayer. He prays for rain to come down and it comes down. He understands prayer. He prays for fire to come down and it comes down. He understands prayer. He prays for fire to come down upon the captains of 50 when he was under attack. And fire came down upon the 50s. He understands the power of prayer. He understands that. But I want to thank the Lord that God does not answer this special prayer that he prays. He is calling for death upon his life. And God does not answer his prayer because his assignment is not yet done. He does not answer his prayer because he still has put fire and anointing upon him. There's still a Lord that he still has to do. I don't know. There are some prayers that other people have made upon you. And they've prayed for God to eliminate you. They have planned everything. And I want to thank the Lord that God did not answer some other people's prayers. Right now, I would not be here. Oh my God, I want to thank the Lord, hallelujah, that God did not answer the prayers of some of the people in my life. Because if God had answered their prayers, I'll be dead long time ago. But I just want to thank the Lord that God did not answer even my own prayer. Hallelujah. He did not answer my own prayer. Let me tell you, brother, I'm just talking about me. I don't know about you. Most of the time you end up praying and you pray and you say, my God, let him die by fire. Let my enemy die by fire. But I want to thank the Lord that God says, even your enemy, I will not eliminate. Because when I bless you, I want them to be there because I prepare a table in front of your enemy. Who's going to celebrate? Who's going to see what I have done? My God, I want to thank the Lord. My God, that God did not answer your prayer. I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about someone in Nigeria. Because if God had answered your prayer, by now your husband will be gone. Because when you were angry, you said you must die right now. I'm tired of you. You must die right now. But I want to thank the Lord that, oh my God, he is still by your side. I thank the Lord that God said no to your prayers. I want to thank the Lord. Oh my God, I'm speaking to someone. I'm speaking to someone. By now, you'll have had the third supervisor because you said you wanted to eliminate him. You did not know that God is going to use your supervisor who doesn't like you to take you to the top. I want to thank the Lord that there are some of the prayers that he said no to me. My God, hallelujah. I thank God that he said no to me when I was down. I thank God that he said no to me when I was depressed. Because when you are not at your right mind, you end up doing things that are not in covenant with God. Oh my God, I want to thank the Lord, because when you are depressed, you end up quitting a job for no reason. When you are depressed, you end up leaving your marriage for no reason. When you are depressed, you end up quitting and leaving this degree for no reason. When you are depressed, you end up not writing your examinations for no reason. I just want to thank the Lord that he said no to me. And he turned around and he said, arise, 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 and get up. Arise and get up. Arise and get up. Hold on. I just want to thank the Lord for saying no when I wanted a yes from God. In his depression state, an angel appears and he bakes bread for him. My God, hallelujah, hallelujah. He bakes bread for him. Look at this, Basila. Look at this. He is not praying for a miracle. He is praying for death. He wants to die. God does not answer him. And God comes in a state of depression. He did not pray for a miracle. But anyway, an angel appears. And it bakes bread for him. My God. Let me tell you, Bazalano. God knows about your challenge. God knows about your pain. God knows about your situation. God knows about your finances. God knows about your business. God knows about the brook that has dried up. God knows about your enemies. Hallelujah. And listen to this. He is doing something about it. He is doing something about it. And now an angel says to him, arise and eat. Arise and eat. This is not the time to kill yourself. Arise and eat. This is not the time to be crying over spilled milk. Arise and eat. This is not the time to quit. Arise and eat. This is not the time to be discouraged. Arise and eat. This is not the time to give up. Arise and eat. This is not the time to think death. Arise and eat. This is not the time to isolate yourself. Arise and eat. This is not the time to hide yourself. Arise and eat. This is not the time to lock yourself in. Arise and eat. I'm speaking to someone right now, and I'm here to tell you, arise from there. Arise from that darkness. Arise from that depression. Arise from that pit. Arise from that depression. Arise out of that demonic spirit. Arise from that spirit of heaviness. Come out. Come out. Come out. Come out. Arise. I'm here to tell you right now. Arise. There's too much that God has prepared for you. Arise. Hallelujah. And an angel gives him food to eat. You see, when you are down, my God, when you are down and fearful, uncertain and worried, you need food from heaven. You need food from heaven. When you are down, you need to eat bread from heaven. My God, am I speaking to someone? And he gives him bread from heaven. He gives him the bread of life. He gives him the word. He gives him bread. He gives him the word. Because there are times where you should not eat physical food. There are times where you need only bread from heaven. My God, because man shall not live by food alone. My God, but by every word that cometh from the mouth of God. My God, the bread of life, the word. You see, when you are despondent, when you are down, down, when you don't know where you are, when you are stuck in life, I just want to encourage you, eat the scroll, my brother, eat the scroll, my sister, eat the scroll, my daughter, just eat the scroll, because this scroll, we are told that the word is powerful, the word is active, the word is living, it is sharper than any two-edged sword, it is powerful, it divides asunder soul and spirit, it even gets to your soul, it even gets to your spirit. That's the power of your word. What do you eat when you are depressed? You eat the word, because the word will cut through your depression, the word will cut through your heaviness, the word will cut through, my God, all your pain, the word will cut through your tears, the word will cut through every spirit, the word will cut through your giving up and your quitting spirit. Eat the word, eat the word. The word will cut out every fear upon your life. The word will cut out every anxiety out of your life. The word will cut out every Jezebel in your life. Just eat the word, my God. And the word, when you eat it, it will tell you to be strong and courageous. It will tell you to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. My God, eat the word. You need the word that will take you out of the pit. You need the word that will take you out of the deep, mighty place. You need the word. You need the word. And God says to Joshua, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but day and night meditate upon it, such that you can be prosperous in everything that you are doing, so that you can have success in whatever you do. And the next verse says, you will then be strong and courageous. It is the word that will make you strong and courageous. It is the word that will tell you that weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. It is the word that will make you strong. It will tell you when you are weak, I will bring strength. I said, let the weak say, I am strong. It is the word that will make you strong and courageous. Be courageous. Hallelujah. Eat the word. It will give you courage. When you have courage, the word will pick you up. When you have courage, courage will pick you up. When you have courage, courage will pick you up. When you have courage, courage will uplift you. When you have courage, courage will make you move forward. Even when you are going through a problem, courage will make you move forward. Even when the Egyptians are behind you, you need courage to move forward. You need courage of the word to go up. My God, to stand up and be confident. My God, you need the word. The word will give you strength. The word will give you strength. The word will make you strong. It will give you strength when you have the word. It will make you to rise up. It will give you strength. It will give strength to your bones to rise up. The Bible says those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength, and they shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and never faint. It says those who are waiting upon the Lord, those who are trusting in the Lord, and not those who are trusting in other people. It didn't say those who are trusting in themselves. It says you must trust in the Lord. You must wait upon the Lord. When you are waiting upon the Lord, strength is coming. When you are waiting upon the Lord, angels are coming. When you are waiting upon the Lord, they will come and give you strength. When you are waiting upon the Lord, they will tell you it's gonna be all right. I'm here to prophesy to someone that it's gonna be okay. It's gonna be all right. I've got a feeling on the inside of me. It's gonna be all right. Don't throw in the towel. Don't kill yourself. Don't die in depression. Don't overdose yourself. It's gonna be all right. It's gonna be all right. Can you imagine you kill yourself today, and after a week, God has turned things around? You might have missed the biggest miracle of your life. I'm here to tell you, just hold on until
until the Lord arrives. I'm here to tell you, just move forward and see what the Lord has for you. I'm here to tell you, don't die in your depression. Don't die in despair. This is not the time to die. Your assignment in this life is still too big. There are generations to impact. Your assignment is still too big. My God, am I speaking to someone? Glory to the Lord. Glory to the Lord. Hallelujah. The word. Look at this. Look at this. And now he eats, and then he goes to sleep again. An angel comes back the second time. Glory to you. Can we just clap hands for the Lord wherever you are in your homes? An angel comes back the second time, and he says to him, rise up and eat. Hallelujah. And then he rises up and eat. But the second meal has a different assignment from the first meal. The first meal was empowerment of where you are coming from. The second meal is empowerment of where you are going. My God, you did not hear me. Hallelujah. The angel is saying to him, I want you to eat this second meal. This time, you are eating it because the journey you are about to take is too great. Where you are going, there are greater things waiting for you. You need strength. You need the anointing. You need food from heaven. You need empowerment. Because where you are going, my God, this is preparation for the journey of greatness. This is preparation for the journey, my God. You are going to levels you have never been. I know you have been to Mount Carmel. I know you have seen the Lord yesterday. But I'm here to tell you, where you are going, you have never experienced it. Because I'm a God who does new things. I'm a God who gives you daily bread. Someone sang a song and said, every day with Jesus is sweeter than the days before. Let me tell you, God will not give you, my God, stale bread. God will not give you the food of yesterday. God will not give you the miracle of last year. God always does something new. Something new. The Israelites had to eat manna every day and quail. They had to throw away the manna of yesterday, because God is a God of miracles. He does a different miracle today. And I'm here to tell you, don't kill yourself. Just arise and shine, for the glory of the Lord is upon you, my brother. Oh, the glory, the anointing is upon you. Don't kill yourself. Don't die in despair. I know you have a problem. I know things are not right. Things are not fine academically. Don't kill yourself. The Lord is about to turn things around. Don't kill yourself because your business is not going well. Don't kill yourself because God is about to turn things around. Don't kill yourself because your marriage is not doing well. God is about to turn things around. There is a journey you are about to take. I know you are stuck. I know you are stagnant. I know your business is not doing well. I know they are calling you from everywhere. They want their money. I'm here to tell you that the journey that you are taking is too great. Arise and walk. It's time to prepare yourself for something that is coming. Arise and walk. Arise and shine. Arise and eat. Don't kill yourself over that problem. arise. Something else is coming in your life. Something else is coming in your life. Don't kill yourself over that business. There are two more businesses that are coming. Don't kill yourself. Don't kill yourself over that job. God is turning things around. He closed that shop. He closed that door. He closed that door so you can hire other people. Don't fret. Don't be afraid. Do not worry about what you're going to eat. Do not worry about what you're going to wear. Do not worry about it. If God can clothe the lily of the valley, which are worth nothing, how much more about you? If God can feed the birds of the air, how much more about you? You are more valuable than every bird that you can ever see. You are more valuable than an eagle. You are more valuable than a peacock. You are more valuable than the rose of Sharon. You are more valuable than every beautiful lily. You are more valuable than every other flower. You are more valuable. My God, am I speaking to someone? You are more valuable than that lion. If the lion can eat every day, every month, how much more about you? I'm here to tell you, God loves you too much to leave you alone. God has done so much to leave you suffering. He suffered on the cross for you to be free. The devil is a liar. He has done so much for you to suffer like that. The devil is a liar. Come out of depression. Come out of that situation. And God is saying to you, with the second meal, he's saying to you, the future is bright. The future is bright. He is saying to you, right now, I want you to eat this second meal, because I want to tell you that you went through Mount Carmel. I want to tell you, you went through Ahab. You went through declarations. I want to tell you, you went through the troop and the fire came down. I want to tell you right now, the same God of Mount Carmel is the same God who is with you right now. And this same God, he is telling you right now that your future is bright. And he is saying to you, for I know the thoughts I have towards you, and these thoughts are thoughts of peace, are not thoughts to harm you. They are thoughts to give you a future and a hope. Let me tell you about a hope. Hallelujah. Because this bread you are eating, the second meal, is for you to have hope. Because if you don't have hope, you will not have expectation. This bread you are eating is about hope. If you don't have hope, you will not have faith. Honey, Bible ring bazalwana. It is faith is the substance of things hoped for. If you have nothing you hope for, then you will not have faith. My God. Hallelujah. And now God is saying to you, I am giving you hope. I am going giving you hope out of despair. I am giving you hope out of your depression. I'm here to tell you right now, where you are going is greater than where you are coming from. I'm here to tell you right now, your future is great. 2020 is more beautiful. I know the first quarter wasn't nice. The first semester was not nice. But I still declare right now, transformation and growth. Transformation and growth. I'm still declaring right now, your 2020 is bright. In 2020, your future is great. I see great things. I see the Lord doing great things. I see the Lord doing things you have never seen. I see the Lord doing things your neighbors have never seen. I see God doing something Israel has never seen. I see God doing a miracle that has never happened. I'm doing great things you have never seen as yet, because God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all you can ever ask or imagine. Greater things, they are on the way. And now, with this second meal, he is saying to Elijah, Jezebel does not have the last word. It's not over, Elijah. Jezebel does not have the last word. It's not over until God says it's over. It's not over. I know the situation say pack your bags, throw in the towel. Hey, 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 hey. It's not over until God says it's over. I'm here to tell someone, it's not over yet. It's not over yet. Your mind tells you it's over. Your friends tell you it's over. Your colleague tell you it's over. Your business partner tell you it's over. Other people say close shop, but I'm here to tell you it's not yet over. It's not over. Jezebel can never have the last say. Only God has the last chapter of your life. No enemy will write the final chapter of your life. They look like they are running your show in your life, but it's God who's running the show. Let me tell you, this last meal is for Elijah, to remind Elijah that even if God is silent, he is still there. Even if God does not bring fire upon Jezebel, he is still there. Even if God does not destroy Jezebel like he did with the prophets of Baal, he is still there. What do you do when God is silent? What do you do, Elijah? You see, Elijah is used to a God of miracle. Elijah is used to a God of thunder. Elijah is used to a God of performance. That's why when God came to Mount Horeb, he came with performance, because Elijah is used to the God of performance. He had to make sure that the mountain shakes, and when the mountain shook, he understood God was there. And guess what? God said, "Kinyako monchangwano," and he shook the mountain. There was a miracle, and God stepped aside, and after some time, there was a still small voice. He wanted to tell him that I'm not just a God of thunder. I also speak in a still small voice. Even if I don't do anything, I am still with you right there. I am still with you. My God, God is still in charge. God is still in charge. In verse 15, I'm closing. God says to Elijah, "What are you doing here? What are you doing here, Elijah? I don't expect you to be here. What are you doing here, Elijah? I expect you to be busy with the work of the Lord. What are you doing here, Elijah?" Oh my God. And Elijah tries to explain, and God says to him, "The same route that you used to come here, I want you to use it to go back. I want you to use it to go back." My God, I want to speak to someone. The same road you used to come here, I want you to use it. Look at your footsteps and go back to where you were. God is saying to you, your assignment is not over. Go back and finish it. God is speaking to someone. Your assignment is not over. I'm not done with you. You will not die right now. Jezebel will not kill you. It's not over. I want you to go back and finish off my assignment. I am glad. I thank the Lord that there is no Jezebel that will kill me before my time, because the Lord has put a purpose in my life. I will not die of corona before my time. There are souls that are waiting for me. He says to him, "I want you to go back. You've got a bigger assignment that I have for you." And he says to him, "I want you to go to Zion. You go to Zion. You anoint him king over Amri. You anoint him king over Syria." And he says, "Oh my God, there is a Jehu that is waiting for you. Go back, look for a young man called Jehu. I want you to anoint him king over Israel. And he says, go back. I want you to go to a young man called Elisha. I want this young man, you walk with him. You mentor him. You go with him. You are not dying now. Who said you are going to die? Before you leash out what I've given unto you, you will not die and go with this grace. You cannot. You must leash it out, unleash it out into Elisha. And he says, I want to thank the Lord Bazalwan. I thank God that Corona will not kill me. There is a Jehu waiting for me. I will not die today. Out of depression, I am coming out because there is Zion waiting for me. I want to speak to a younger generation who just want to kill themselves. I want to say there's something great in your life that God has put. God has put a great thing in you. When things are not going well right now, don't kill yourself, because there is a Jehu that is waiting for you to impact. There is a generation that is waiting for your career. There is a generation that is waiting for your gift. There is a generation that is waiting for a doctor. There is a generation that is waiting for an engineer. There is a generation that is waiting for a pastor. There is a generation that is waiting for an accountant. There's a generation that is waiting for your gift. Don't kill yourself. You are not robbing yourself. You are also robbing us of the gift. You are not only robbing us, you are robbing also the next generation. There are people who will remain the same until you step into their lives. There's an Elisha that will remain the same until you touch his life. My God, my God, my God, my God, I am concluding. You see, the assignment upon your life is more like the story of a donkey and a master. Hallelujah. The assignment upon your life is more like the donkey and the master. The master is putting a luggage upon the donkey. And as long as the donkey is holding the luggage and carrying the luggage, the master will make sure the donkey is safe. As long as the donkey is carrying the burden, the master will make sure the donkey is safe. The master will make sure it is fed, will make sure it is in perfect health, will make sure that it guides it, will make sure that it goes, it orders itself. Hallelujah. I'm here to talk to someone that there is a master who has put an assignment upon your life and is saying to you like a donkey, no one will touch you because I've put something great upon you. No one will hate you. I put something great upon you. When you are depressed, I give you a meal to rise up. When you are down, I give you food to rise up. When you don't have food, I supply for you. When you are weak, I give you water, because there is a journey you must take. And until you arrive where the luggage is going, you will not die. I want to talk to someone who is saying, I'm a donkey, I am useless. But I want to tell you, a useless donkey is important because a master has put a luggage on it. I thank God that I was a donkey in my family. I was useless, but I want to thank the Lord that he put a burden upon me. And he said, you are special. He said, I'm chosen in him before the foundations of this world. He knitted me together and gave me a special gift in my mother's womb. My God, glory to the Lord. I'm concluding right now. Let me speak to an Elijah. I'm finishing. Let me speak to an Elijah. Elijah, I want to tell you, the same fire that came upon Mount Carmel is still upon you right now. The same fire that you called and 50 captains of men died because of the fire. The fire is still there in you. Elijah, 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 Elijah. Nothing has changed. Elijah, Elijah, the anointing is still upon you. Elijah, Elijah, God is still with you. Elijah, Elijah, the burden is still upon you. Elijah, Elijah, the purpose is still there. Elijah, Elijah, don't kill yourself because your assignment is bigger. The same fire is still there. It reminds me, my God, it reminds me of Jeremiah. Jeremiah was attacked by Pasha, a man called Pasha, and Pasha put him in prison. And the Bible says he spoke to the Lord. Jeremiah spoke to the Lord and he said, I will not preach this word anymore. I will not do the work anymore. I will not do this assignment anymore. But then he comes back to the Lord and he said, I wanted to quit. I wanted to leave this thing. But then the word was like fire. Shut up in my bones. It was like fire shut up in my bones. When I was discouraged, there was a fire inside my bones that said, rise up. When I wanted to stop doing the work of the Lord, I wanted to quit. I wanted to give up. I was discouraged by Pasha. I was discouraged by Jezebel. But something on the inside sprang up and it started burning. It started burning. It was like fire shut up in my bones. It's fire shut up in my bones. When I'm discouraged, there's a burning in me that burns discouragement. When I'm depressed, there's a fire in me that burns depression. When I'm about to give up, there's a fire in me that burns the give up spirit. I will not quit. There is fire. And I want to speak to someone. And I want to tell this generation, the same fire that was upon Jeremiah is the same fire that is upon you right now. The same fire that was upon the grave, the same fire that resurrected Jesus is the same power that is in you right now. I'm here to tell you that in Acts chapter 2, the Bible says the Holy Ghost came in a form of fire and he sat on me. He sat on them. It is my prayer this morning that as I go through this depression, may the Holy Ghost fire sit on me. It is my prayer this morning as I go through discouragement, lying down right under the tree, I pray, Holy Ghost, sit on me. I refuse that depression must sit on me. I pray for the Holy Ghost to sit on me. Sit on me, Holy Ghost, when I feel like quitting. Sit on me, Holy Ghost, when I feel like throwing the towel. Sit on me, Holy Ghost, when I feel like doing something funny. Sit on me, Holy Ghost. My God, I pray for the fire to sit on me right now. I pray, sit on me, Holy Ghost, when I see the tablets and I want to overdose myself. Holy Ghost, sit on me, Holy Ghost, when I take out the gun from the safe and I want to do something funny. Holy Ghost, sit on me, Holy Ghost, when I want to give up on life. Holy Ghost, sit on me when I want to do a funny thing at university and fall from a higher building. Holy Ghost, sit on me when I have suicidal thoughts. Holy Ghost, sit on me, Holy Ghost. Whenever I have a quitting spirit upon me, Holy Ghost, sit on me, Holy Ghost. The same fire that was upon Jeremiah, let it come upon us right now. Father, we thank you. Father, we bless you. We give you praise. Holy Ghost, we thank you for your fire. Sit on us. Sit on us. Sit on us, Holy Ghost. Sit on us, Holy Ghost. When I go through the valley, Holy Ghost, sit on me. When I go through the challenges, Holy Ghost, sit on me. When I go through a winter season, Holy Ghost, sit on me. I pray I don't do a funny thing. I pray I don't quit quicker. I pray, Holy Ghost, that I don't miss my miracle before my time. Holy Ghost, sit on me, Holy Ghost. Sit on me, Holy Ghost. Father, I pray for this generation. I know right now we're going through this corona crisis. We've got challenges, financial challenges. We've got challenges at work. We've got challenges in our businesses. Our businesses aren't doing well. But I just want to thank you, my Father. Thank you for hope. Thank you for the Holy Ghost. We have overcome. I pray for anyone going through a dark season. Holy Ghost, I pray you sit on them. Sit on them and tell them all is well. Sit on them and tell them God is good. Sit on them and tell them things will change. Sit on them and tell them ngengekhlalokunje. Sit on them, my Father. Sit on them until the situation changes. Father, we thank you and bless you. I bind every spirit of depression. I bind every spirit of heaviness upon the younger generation. I bind every spirit of discouragement upon our couples. I bind every spirit of depression upon our business people. I bind every spirit of depression upon our men and women of God. I bind the spirit of depression upon the church. I bind the spirit of depression upon our country, Africa, upon our continent, upon our country. I bind every spirit of depression right now. Anyone going through whatever is going through right now, I thank you for the anointing to arise and shine, the anointing to arise and take another journey. Father, I thank you. Father, I bless you. I give you praise, my God. And if you are here and you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I want to pray with you. It is easy to accept the Lord. You just confess with your mouth that he is Lord, and then you are saved. That's as easy like that. Just follow me as I pray. Father God, I accept you today. I accept you, Jesus. I acknowledge you today as Lord and Savior. Today, I am born again. I'm a new creation. In Jesus' name. If you have prayed that prayer, you are saved. You are born again. Just get a church where they preach Christ crucified. May God richly bless you. Amen.